At this time, what I'd like to do is welcome everyone to the 2017 Southwest Division Table Topic and International Speech Contest.
Here, here, here.
Okay, at this time, what I'd like to do is welcome Stella Morris to the floor.
Welcome.
Morning.
We have to wake up in the morning. I want to recognize the leadership in our district right now, in our division right now. Lawrence Fields is back where?
Right here.
Okay. So he's the division director right here. Is Michelle Lansky, an area director, and Carol Henry, which is here. Larry Hill. My mother, yes, Griffin, which is not here, she's sailing on the seas. So without any further ado, let's get started, and let me recognize our PDQ, and that is Iqbal Akbar.
All right.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, friends, family, Toastmasters, and guests.
Yay!
That's the energy I need to feel and feel in here. Excellent. Welcome to the most skillful, stylish, and soulful Southwest Division contest for the spring season. So I pointed out, my name is Iqbal Acha. I am the program quality director, but for the next few hours, I will be humbly here to serve as your contest toastmaster.
Here, 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 here.
Before I go any farther, I would like for everyone to feel that Toastmaster's love and turn to your neighbor. Smile. I didn't say shake, I just said smile. And I want you to ask them just one question. So do you have one of these?
Yeah.
The answer probably like, yes, I do. So if it is, I want you to show them the power button on your phone. See, this is how I turn off my phone. And I would like for you to all, out of respect for the contestants as well as your audience members, to please turn your phones off. And I ask for off because I know that sometimes we accidentally put it on vibrate, and you can hear the vibration of the contest. And so, again, out of respect, let's make sure. I'll give everybody about 10 seconds to hear the chimes, the dings, you know, the way that powers down. Let's hear some of that music right now. This is the only time we're going to have music this morning. I see most of you are respectful enough to keep it on vibrate before we got here. All right. Now, again, we are all here to see a fantastic table topics and an international speech contest.
Of course.
And as Stella had pointed out, that there are several individuals here in this room that do deserve a little bit of extra noteworthy attention, simply because of the amount of time, energy, and their commitment to serving the district. When we talk about contest, it's important for us to understand that district leadership is the people that make everything happen. And I say that because it's an arduous task. There are some people that I do believe deserve just a few seconds of attention. The first I would like to begin by having our district director, Mr. Ivory Gwynn, stand. We also have in our presence our club growth directors, Tiffany Howard. Director, Mr. Lawrence Field.
All right.
Our Northeast Division Director is Sue Chudasama. Our Central East Division Director, Ms. Anise Anderson. We also have with us our South Division Director, Mr. Jerome Raleigh. level, which hold a very, very strong place in my heart. Our division, our Southwest D31 Area Director, Ms. Stella Lawrence. Our Southwest Area Director, D32, Michelle Lansky. Our Southwest D33 Area Director, Mr. Larry Hughes. Our Southwest D34 Area Director, Ms. Carol Henry. And I also have from the South, and Mr. Burt Howard, our South S51 Area Director.
Yeah, Burt.
Now, I, like all of you, I'm a human, and I can make mistakes. Have I missed anyone that is a dignitary that I did not acknowledge?
Yeah, so.
Previously done, but I am a program calling in.
Yay!
Yay! Alright. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, we will have two contests, the International Speech Contest and the Table Topics Contest. Our first contest will be the Table Topics Contest.
Yes!
And when that contest... I love the energy, boys and girls. It's awesome. So when that contest has concluded, we will have a 10-minute break. We will go and enjoy some of the refreshments that we have. When we resume, we will start the International Speech Contest at that time. We always have a disclaimer at the beginning of every contest, and I just say, learn to master this the way that any good salesman would. Contestants, timers, ballots, counters, and sergeant-at-arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of this contest. Everyone is aware of the Toastmasters International rules that govern this contest. No one, not even you, Ivory, should enter or leave the room during the contestants' presentations. You may do so if you need to leave the room. You may do so during the 1 minute of silence between each contestant or after the last contestant has spoken. With that, let this contest begin. All of you should have an agenda with you. On your chair, in your hands, in a padfolio, and for those of you that were quick to sit down, probably underneath your dish. So in case you don't have it in your hands, take it out and let me read to you the speaking order for the Table Topics Contest. Table Topics Contestant number one will be Roger Nelson. Roger Nelson will be Table Topics Contestant number one. Our second Table Topics Contestant number two, Miguel Contreras. Miguel Contreras will be Table Topics Contestant number two. Table Topics Contestant number three will be Otto Clark. Otto Clark will be Table Topics Contestant number three. And Table Topics Contestant number four will be Matthew Culp. Matthew Culp. John Harris is not here. This is not a replacement. You may remove him from your list. So we have four Table Topics contestants.
Mr. Contest Master, I'm going to ask the Table Topic contestants to start out here in the back of the room and then use this aisle for safety. This aisle for safety. So we have contestants start here in the back of the room and then use this aisle to come up.
So I will ask a sergeant-at-arms to stand and have all of the Table Topics contestants leave the room with that sergeant-at-arms except Table Topics contestant number one. Which sergeant-at-arms is taking them out? Wave your hand. Okay. Now ready to hear from our Table Topics contestants. As I said, there will be 1 minute of silence between each contestant. timekeepers, but I advise you to do so. Please signal me with the green signal when 1 minute is up. After all the contestants have spoken, the judges will be given as much time as they need to complete their ballots. We will now begin the table topics contest. I get a good line of sight with my contestants. Roger Nelson, if you could go back to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell them? If you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell them? Roger Nelson, table topics contestant number one. Table topics contestant number one, Roger Nelson.
Thank you, Mr. Topic Master, and fellow Toastmasters and guests. 12 years old for me was an interesting, and I will tell you, not a very happy age. You see, I was one of those kids that just didn't fit in. I was the kid who had no friends, who wasn't any good at sports. I was the kid who everybody picked on. In fact, I've never been formally diagnosed, but I think I am 99% sure that I have Asperger's syndrome. I went on the website one time and went down the list of dots. Yep, that's me. 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 Right down the list. So I'm pretty sure I have it, even though I've technically never been formally diagnosed. So 12 years old, that's 7th grade. 7th grade for me, frankly, was a living hell. I mean, not only was I picked on, not only was I abused in the sense that every little quirk of mine was publicly broadcast to the rest of the classroom in school so I could be publicly ridiculed. Being punched or threatened with being punched was part of my daily routine. So I would say that, what would I tell myself? I could go back to when I was 12 years old. What would I tell myself? I would tell myself, hang in there. It gets better. This doesn't last. So many kids who went through what I went through don't make it to adulthood. They commit suicide, or they get a gun and they go shoot up the school or something crazy like that. Some of them, a lot of people who are considered in the autism spectrum are in much worse shape than I am. I'm actually, as an adult, I think I'm a fairly normal person. Never mind that I think I have Asperger's syndrome. As an adult, I have become, with time, a fairly normal person. Granted, it maybe took me till I was 30 until I got the social skills of a 15-year-old, but I'm kind of there now. So, the message I have is, hang in there. It gets better. This won't last. And that's a message I think anybody who's in my situation should hear. Mr.
Tucker. Wow. May we please have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Miguel, if you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell them? If you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell them? Table Topics contestant number two, Miguel Contreras. Miguel Contreras, Table Topics contestant number two.
If I could go back at the age of 12 years old, what would I do? What would I tell myself? Well, I'm 41 years old right now. And the age of 12 years old, I was hanging out with not such a good crowd. And because of that, kind of stumbled down in my teenage years. Mm-hmm. If I could go back at the age of 12 years old, I would tell myself that it's okay to be you at the time, but not to be hanging around with certain people to try and to impress others, to try to be the number one in that little group, to try not to say, I belong, this corner is mine, which in reality was never ours. But I could go back and say to me that who you are, and if you believe in who you are within, I believe that I would have probably been a little bit more advanced at the time. The age of 12 years old is a very, you know, entering the 13, being 13 years old is kind of pretty time that the youth should get the proper guidance. And especially in the low-income communities where gangs are glamorized, I think just being alone and just being with you, that there is the key for success. So if I could go back and tell me, I'd probably give me a hug and say, you know what, go to the boys club or something. Thank you very much.
Again, may we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark the ballots. Otto, if you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell him? If you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell him? Table Topics contestant number three, Otto Clark. Otto Clark, Table Topics.
Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests. I think of the 4th of July, because when I was 12 years old, that was the best time of my life. We would have barbecues, and my father, all his pals would come over and get drunk. But that was the funniest part of it. But I would tell myself that life is short. We don't have that much time. Treasure these moments, these seconds that we have with family, friends, and loved ones. Honor them, love them. Make up with them when you have any type of spats. Because I always think about 4th of July. I believe at that time, 1985, I'm dating myself. But I just remember the hot dogs, the music, the laughing, the fun. Just an amazing time with my wonderful family. And I say to honor these times because most of them aren't around anymore. My father had passed, most of his friends are gone, but I'm so grateful that I have those memories to latch on to. And even today, I don't take things so serious. I honor every moment. I treasure the people around me, because that's what that 12-year-old did back then. That 12-year-old loved life, loved the world, and that's what I give to you. Thank you.
May we please have one moment of silence while the judges mark the ballot. Matthew, if you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell him? If you could go back in time, Matthew, if you could go back in time to the 12-year-old you, what would you tell him? Table Topics contestant number 4, Matthew Cope. Matthew Cope, Table Topics contestant.
Embarking on those years where I'm about to cause a lot of issues and mischievous. Probably a lot of problems for my parents, too. I wish that when I went back into time, and I can talk to my little 12-year-old self before I cause all those problems, dignitaries, fellow Toastmasters and guests, I would tell 12-year-old me to own it. To own everything you do. To not blame other people for the circumstance that you're in. Your actions, your thoughts, everything you do is because of you. It's not because of someone else. And someone else did that. And someone said this to me. And someone made me feel this way. So I did that. No. I would have told my 12-year-old self to own it, that it's on me. It's not on everyone else. Things happen in life. And when you own it, that's when you become a man. Contest chair.
Silent while the judges complete marking the ballots and have them collected by the ballot counters. Thank you. so happy to say that our first contest is now done and it's being marked. But it is important for me to invite one of our dignitaries up to the stage because there is some district news that we do want to share. And just in time, walking into that room with a smile on his face, I would like to call on Mr. Bill Morrill, our cultural director.
A 12-year-old me would say, go, Cubs, go! Yes. Mr. Contest Master, Mr. District Director, I had a chance to spend the summer in Ohio, and I had a chance to see the Ohio State football stadium. 100,000 people can fit in that.
Wow.
That's big. Now, we don't have 100,000 people here, but we have a lot of chairs filled in, almost a whole row packed. But imagine if we only had the first row packed, if the majority of the seats were empty. And that's what happens when people don't hear about events, or don't people sign up for events, or if you're a club, you don't pay your dues. Now, right now, we have 8,000 people paying. Give yourselves a round of applause. Well done. Yeah. That would fill up a lot of rooms like this, but we still have 2,000 more to go. We still have a number of people who haven't paid yet. Most of you, I'm sure you've paid, and thank you for paying. If you've forgotten, you still have time. Talk to your treasurer, talk to any of your seven officers, say, hey, I want to give you this money. I want Toastmasters to keep going. I want to fill in the seats, both in our club meetings, as well in our conferences and in all of our contests. So I encourage you, if you know somebody in your club, give them a little nudge, give them a little wink. Hey, let me help you out. Are you short this month? Let me help you out. Pay me back. Yeah. Whatever you can do, make sure that you get those members paid, because that's how we are able to afford great things like the donuts and back. Let's hear it for that. Spread the band. Wonderful things we do as a district cost money, and Toastmasters wants to give us that money, but it's all back on how many dues we have. So please continue to do a great job where you don't pay dues. Let's pay the rest, and we're going to finish strong. We're going to be a distinguished district.
Yes. Yeah. Bill, I feel like I want to double my dues right now. That's awesome. A couple quick things. How many of you received a raffle ticket?
Yeah.
Probably a better question. How many of you did not receive a raffle ticket? All right. Well, if you did not receive a raffle ticket, our illustrious leader, Mr. Ivory Goode, our district director, he is going to be handing them out to you. So in the intermission, please do stop by to come see him, and he will make sure that you get one. We are going to be giving away prizes right after the intermission. But before we get there, and I know I'm standing between you and the sugar and caffeine that my body's craving right now, I do want to quickly bring your attention to what is up and coming. So all of you are here to either support one of your contestants, maybe a club member, or just to see a really fantastic contest. But as all of you know, the winners are going to go on and take their A game and bring it to a greater stage, and that is the district contests at the district conference. And the district conference information can be found on the inside of your agenda, bottom right hand. It's the Launching a New Legacy Spring Conference. This is going to take place on Friday, April 28th and Saturday, April 29th. The winners of both contests are going to go on and compete at a district level. There's a lot of things that I can talk about, but I'm just going to boil it down to three simple things that you should really want to put this on your calendar and make sure that you're there. Number one, contests. I mean, if you're here today and you're watching the level of quality that's on stage, imagine it multiplied by about 100. So every time I've gone to a district conference, and every time it gets better and better, you're like, oh my God, I would not want to be on that stage. But you're like, I'm going to take down everything that that person said, because that was really good. And this is how we become better communicators and better leaders. We watch experts on the stage. So be there for the contest. Number two, we are also flying in our international director, Mr. Magnus Jansen. He is flying all the way from Indianapolis, Indiana. He is coming here to share with us about 17 years worth of leadership. And for those of us that either work in a leadership capacity or even serve as club officers and above, it's valuable to hear how we can improve that level. And of course, the third biggest reason is the networking that you'll be. The networking that you'll have, the opportunity to meet new Toastmasters, rekindle some relationships with old ones, and then also to be able to vote for your future. Because at the business meeting, that is where the new leaders will be identified for the new District 103, which is our split, and the continuing on District 30. So there's a lot of things to see. The agenda is already up. The Eventbrite's out there. If you're not sure where to find it, go to district30toastmasters.org or D30, the number 30, Toastmasters with the plural.org. And on the front screen, you will see a little picture that you can click on Spring Conference. It will take you to the page and the Eventbrite registration as well. Again, I know I'm standing between you and sugar and caffeine, so let's go ahead and, Madam Timers, if I can have 10 minutes on the clock, please help yourself to the refreshments, and we'll see you back at 9:25. If you could not help yourself and you just happen to turn the on button back on, let's go ahead and turn to your neighbor one more time and say, this is my off button. See how it works? Let's shut off your phones. Again, out of respect for the contestants that are putting a lot of energy. Let's turn off our phones so that we can show respect to not only our contestants that are putting a lot of energy and effort into being on stage today, but also out of respect to the audience. Now, before we get started, I would like to, for all of us to feel a little bit more engaged. We're all energetic, we're all excited, but I'm feeling that we're not totally like one Toastmasters family yet. And so for us to do so, I would like to call my fellow district quintet members, Mr. Bill Moreau, Ms. Tiffany Howard, and Mr. Ivory Gwynn, up to the stage. What I would like for them to do is I would like for them to make you feel like you're part of this family. So, you know, whenever you visit your aunts, your uncles, moms, and dads you haven't seen in a while, they always give you food or something to go home with, right? So we're going to give you some prizes. And for you to actually potentially receive a prize, you should have a blue raffle ticket. Do you all have one of these?
Yeah.
Good. If you do not have one, please raise your hands.
We have two.
All right, so we'll take about 30 seconds here. Ivory's going to run a marathon and get...
Ivory's not going to run another.
All of you should have a number. Let me pop that back in here, make it fair. I am going to pull a ticket, one at a time, and I am going to read the number. However, for us to feel like a Toastmasters family, I'm going to ask you to do something for me. When I read a number that matches your ticket, you are going to say hot. So for example, 5.
Hot.
4.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
Right? And then as we continue down and I read the last three numbers, just say hot. And I know, no matter how many times I say this, don't go, "Oh, I hate it." Because then that confuses the people that said hot. So just say hot, and when you win, stand up and we will all applaud and bring your ticket with you. Are we all ready?
Yes.
You guys are sharp, man. Love it. All right. 5.
Hot.
4.
Hot.
6.
Hot.
8.
Hot.
5.
Hot.
Oh. Did I not just... 7.
Hot.
8, 5, 7. Who has it?
Jerry.
So I know that all of us have the same first three numbers, right?
Yeah.
But you're still going to play with me, right?
Yeah.
So instead of going hot, 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 you're just going to go 5, 4, 6, and you're going to say
hot.
Yep. 5, 4, 6.
Hot.
Thank you. 8.
Hot.
9.
Hot. Oh my goodness.
And it is hot here. 3.
Hot.
Got it.
Hey, Jerry.
Well, first, let's see. What does Jerry win?
It's the Toastmasters pen and pencil set. And Jerry is eluding his gift to the newest Toastmaster in the room. So who has become a Toastmaster in the last 30 days? 60 days?
They haven't figured out the contests are worth going to yet.
Oh, can't play that way. Who's joined Toastmasters since July 1st?
Okay. All right.
So we are pulling We cannot win.
Darn it. 5, 4, 6. Eight. Six. Cuatro.
Management,
advanced
manual.
I know two people that want that.
Hi.
All right, 5, 4, 6.
Hi.
8.
Hi.
8.
Hi.
8. All right. Next raffle prize?
Amazon gift card?
Oh!
Going.
5, 4, 6. Eight. Five. Four.
Oh, fine.
Who's going shopping?
All right. So when you need a gavel, there you go.
Got a gavel.
Right.
Gavel pencil.
5, 4, 6. Thank you for loving me with that. 8. Five. Nine.
Yay!
You guys have been playing along really nicely. So, after 5, 4, 6, 8, 4,
84.
So great.
Greg wins all the time. He's so lucky.
So competent leader manual, 5, 4, 6. All right, 5, 4, 6. Eight. Eight.
Engagement.
That was engagement. all this hot, hot, hot has actually made this room hot, 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 hot. So I appreciate everyone's patience, so do know that we are speaking to the hotel management, seeing if they can go ahead and crank down the temperature. We have one name.
First time it's going to happen for me in every division.
Again, that's another topic.
I'll lend you my coat.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, please be seated for our next contest. We will now begin the International Speech Contest! As I've already mentioned, again, please make sure your phones are off, not on vibrate or silent. Again, we can hear the vibrations, and we want to be respectful for our contestants and audience. Sergeant-at-Arms, of course, will secure the doors. Again, as a friendly and gentle reminder, no one is able to leave or enter the room during a contestant's presentation. If you do need to use the facilities, take a drink of water, or make a phone call, please do so in between every contestant. I will now read to you the speaking order for the International Speech Contest. International Speech Contestant number one, Len Hisney. Len Hisney, International Speaking Contestant number one. International Speaking Contestant number two, Michael Scampini. Michael Scampini, International Speaking Contestant number two. International Speaking Contestant number three, Matthew Culp. Matthew Culp, International Speaking Contestant number three. International Speaking Contestant number four, Miguel Contreras. Miguel Contreras, International Speaking Contestant number four. And finally, International Speech Contestant number five, Mr. Otto Clark. Otto Clark, International Speech Contestant number five. Does anyone need me to repeat the order of the contestants? Fantastic. We will now proceed with the International Speech Contest. Now again, a reminder, there will be 1 minute of silence between each contestant. Madam Timers, when I ask you to do so, please signal me with the green light when 1 minute is done. And after all the contestants have spoken, the judges will be given an unlimited amount of time for them to complete their ballots. We will now begin the International Speech Contest. International Speech Contestant number one, Len Hisney, a shout out to silent letters. A shout out to silent letters. Len Hisney.
Mr. Toastmaster, our new Toastmaster family, and guests for this morning. Most linguists agree that the American English is one of the toughest languages to learn as a second language. It's because of such things as words that sound the same but are spelt differently and mean different things, like two, two, and two, do, do, and do, and other things such as idiomatic expressions. I cut down the tree, now I have to cut it up. And then there's always my favorite, is the silent letters. Where did that come from? All 26 of these guys fought equally hard to make it onto the roster. The rest are still called hieroglyphics. But also, at times, 20 members of the alphabet are asked to be quiet. Hey, G, when we want guts, grit, and glory, we want you right out front, loud and proud. But if you got to gnaw on something, would you please do it quietly? Hey, P, when we throw a picnic and you bring the pickles and the peppers, oh, we're glad to see you. But if you have pneumonia, we're just as soon you stay home. And Kay, when you come out to kick the ball and fly your kite, you're a ball, we're glad to see you. But if you knew then what you know now, would you have agreed to be the K? Think about it. But just like silent letters, there are people in our society that are doing great and wonderful things and never get their proper recognition. Our news is full of political outrageous activity and violence at home and abroad. You all know the name Rob Blagojevich. You all know the name Drew Peterson. How many of you know the name Ken Dunn? About 35 years ago, Ken Dunn was working on his thesis, and he was pondering the problem of vast tracts of land throughout the city of Chicago that were vacant, abandoned lots, and they were strewn with debris and trash. And he was also struggling with the problem of vast unemployment in his neighborhood. And he couldn't help but think that if you use some creativity to bring these seemingly useless excesses together, that you could produce something positive. And so he borrowed a van from a friend to test the theory. He loaded drums in the back and he got three or four volunteers from the neighborhood. And they went around and collected empty bottles and other glass from vacant lots. They filled the drums, went down to the local glass manufacturing plant, and sold their collection as raw materials. He split the money with his friends, and he was done. He had proved his theory. He was going home to write his thesis. Until one of the guys asked him, "What time do we work tomorrow?" Wow. All of a sudden, he was embarrassed to tell him this was just an experiment. He had no intention to come back. Out of that experience, Ken Dunn founded the Resource Center of Chicago. It's a nonprofit environmental education organization solely dedicated to recycling waste product out of the city of Chicago. A short while later, Ken also founded the City Farm. The City Farm operates urban agriculture by farming vacant lands throughout the city. They produce up to 80 varieties of vegetables and sell their top quality produce to high-end restaurants throughout the city. Each 1 acre that they farm generates $160,000 worth of revenue annually.
Wow.
And supports anywhere from 3 to 5 full-time jobs paying family-raising wages. City Farm also operates as a community center, conducting business education classes with an entrepreneurial mindset. So this is the type of story I believe we should be seeing on the nightly news. This is what we need to hear more of. And so, as a shout out to Ken Dunn and all the other silent letters in our lives, let me say this. If you have a green thumb up, if you have a real knack for gardening, and you don't mind getting down on your knees and getting dirty, I urge you to listen to your heart and consider making a solemn oath to go volunteer at the City Farm. If you're a numb from all the negative news and their words cut you like a knife, then you can know that you could also help to Ziggin a new approach whereby all Peopoli could develop into their full character together. With our combined knowledge, we can help write a new scenario for society. Mr. Toastman.
Ladies and gentlemen, may we please have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots.
Thank you.
contenders. International speech contestant number two, Michael Scampini. You choose your own sunshine. You choose your own sunshine. Michael Scampini.
What are two words you're sure to hear every kid say on the second day of summer vacation? I'm bored. And when I was 10, I ran out of things to do. In fact, it made me miserable. So, to overcome this misery, I did what any kid would do. I bothered my parents. I found my mom and I would say, Mom, I'm bored. What's there to do? She said, Mike, you don't have to be bored. You choose your own sunshine. And I said, Mom, that doesn't make any sense. So I went to my dad, hoping he had some more useful advice. And I said, Dad, I'm bored. What's there to do? And he said, what every dad says, go ask your mom. Contest chair, Toastmasters and guests, have you ever been told something that changed your life forever? In 2001, I came home from school one day, and my mom, she wanted to talk. She sat me down in the kitchen, and she said, Mike, I have cancer. She saw as my eyes filled with tears. But she said, it's okay, we caught it early, and it will be fine. And it was fine. My mom went through chemo and radiation, and she beat the cancer. I was relieved. A few months later, I came home from school, and the house was empty. Dad had taken mom to the hospital. Turns out the treatment made my mom very sick. Anxiously waited. And suddenly, the phone rang. It was my dad. I said, Dad, what's going on? How's Mom? And he said, Mike, Mom died. I was crushed. I was lost. And I pushed through high school, and things got better. Before, they got much worse. Because 5 years later, in the kitchen of my childhood home, I watched my dad collapse, and he died. When I was 14, and I lost my mom, I was lost. And when I was 19, and I lost my dad, I was truly broken. Because I knew they were gone forever. But life goes on. And I had some life choices to make. Some were good. Some, not so good. I chose to go to college and study business, and I chose to work. And I found a job at a restaurant called Frankie's Pizza. Here I met Jane. Jane has helped me through some of the toughest choices of my life. Jane became like a mother to me. And things were looking better, at least it appeared that way. But on the inside, I was still broken. So to fill my void, I chose to drink. I was a student by day, partier by night. I chose to avoid the pain and just have fun. My mornings consisted of me, very hungover, peeling myself off the couch, checking for any mystery tattoos, and then I was off to class. It was fun, but then it wasn't fun. It was miserable. I became very depressed. And I didn't know any other way. And finally, I hit rock bottom. On August 11, 2014, I woke up after one of the worst weekends of drinking of my entire life. I didn't want to die, but I no longer knew how to live anymore. Jane called and said, Mike, you weren't at work yesterday. Is everything okay? And she knew it was worse than ever. So she picked me up and brought me to the hospital, where the doctors would check me up to make sure I was okay and calm me down. So now that I felt calm, I felt hungry. So we went to the cafeteria. And if you had been sitting there with us in that cafeteria, you would have heard Jane say something that changed my life forever. She said, Mike, you can keep on drinking, and then finding misery, or you can choose to stop drinking and find happiness. The choice is yours. And I thought about that. And before I could even answer, she said, "You will go to AA and you will quit drinking." I guess I didn't have a choice. But I did. And I went to AA 4 times a week and I quit drinking 1 day at a time. And since then, I'm 971 days, 9 hours, 48 minutes, and 13 seconds sober. And in the meantime, I found a job that I love, where I was quickly promoted to an executive. I met someone very special who has inspired me every day. And I even overcame my lifelong fear of public speaking. Well, still working on that one. So what tough choices do you have to make? An important lesson I learned through all of this is bad things happen to good people and to bad people. But it's not what happens to you. It's how you choose to react that will make the difference. And I finally understand what my mom meant. You do choose your own sunshine. You can find light in this world by making better choices. So when you're walking out that door today, remember, no matter what your situation is, you always have the power to choose. The choice is yours.
May we please have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark the ballots. International speech contestant number 3, Matthew Culp. The space. Matthew Culp, international speaking contestant number 3.
Of life is what you make it. 90% of life is how you take it. Dignitaries, fellow Toastmasters, and guests, when I first heard this quote, I didn't like it. Because I always thought that life is what you make it. What does life is what you make it mean to you? I always thought it meant that you are in charge of your life. As I pondered this quote, I began to think and I realized that 10% is your plan. The other 90% is life. And life doesn't go as planned. That 90% is your reaction to life. Maybe one day you don't get much sleep. You're running a little late to work because you hit a little traffic and your boss makes a snarky comment to you about being late. And then your significant other calls you on the phone and says, "Do you know if we have any peanut butter?" Peanut butter? I can't talk about peanut butter right now. When life doesn't go as planned, how do you respond? How do you take it? Has anyone here ever wished that maybe they would have just said nothing at all. I know I have. And lately in life, I've been working on my response to when things don't go as planned. And here's why. One day, I had a plan. Like most overachievers do. I'm on my way to the gym on my lunch break, and I had a plan. I was going to work out, shower, and get back to the office, all within 1 hour. And on my way to the gym, my gym is in the back of a hospital campus that is also a rehab center. I'm flying through campus at 30 miles an hour, speed limit's 20. I see a stop sign, no one's around. I lightly tap my brake at probably about 30 miles an hour. Right now, everyone wants me to get pulled over, I know. And all of a sudden, in front of me is a big blue van going 5 miles an hour. Who goes 5 miles an hour? I can't get around him. This was not part of my plan. So I begin to respond, like I always respond. Move out of the way! And I just start losing it. But right before I hit my horn, I remember a quote that I had seen earlier that day. It says, everyone you meet is going through a battle you know nothing about. That's everyone in this room. Nice to meet you. So I laid off. I let them drive, pull in, and park. I quickly parked my car, I ran into my gym, I changed my clothes, and I just started getting huge. And then all of a sudden, over the loudspeaker, I hear, emergency, emergency, all staff to the parking lot. Because I'm kind, I run out, and I begin to lend, I wanted to lend a helping hand. And as I get there, there's the man on the ground. There's staff around him, helping him. And near the man is an empty wheelchair. And near the wheelchair is that big blue van. And I stood there frozen because I started thinking about all of my honks I've made in life. Not just in my car, but maybe verbally to loved ones, friends, families, and strangers. There's a quote from a Holocaust survivor and famous author named Viktor Frankl. He says, between a stimulus and a response, there is a space. And in that space, we have the power to choose a response. And in our response is our growth and our freedom. See, that day I grew. I grew in perspective that maybe my responses to when things weren't going my way, weren't all that kind, and had a greater impact on the people around me. I also was free. I was free from feeling guilty about honking. I was free because I had done nothing at all and had found a space. Lately in my life, I've been trying to apply this as things don't go as planned. Just this past Wednesday, our nice rainy Wednesday, I was supposed to have a sloppy Joe. My wife was going to make me sloppy Joes. We had a little miscommunication. And she was a little upset about the miscommunication. So I come home from work, my wife and kids aren't there, and either are my sloppy jokes. She came in fiery. She was not happy, and I could see it. So I offered to make sloppy jokes. And she said, I already ate at Ashley's. Okay. And then she continued to tell me that I need to practice what I preach about communication, time management, and efficiencies. That hit me deep. And I said, communication? If you would have told me you didn't make sloppy joes, I could have efficiently picked up food on the way home and I could be spending time with my family. But But luckily, I said that in my head. So I took a deep breath. I took it. I could have made that situation a lot worse, but I took it. I then went out into the rain, and I got my own food. When life doesn't go as planned for you, how do you take it? How do you respond? How do you treat other people around you? And maybe, sometimes, things are just better left. Contest chair.
International speech contestant number 4, Miguel Contreras. Love within. Love within. Miguel Contreras.
It is said that love conquers all. It is said that love stops wars. It is said that when you get to meet love, it brings a sunshine into your life. Master Toastmasters, Toastmasters, do you remember the first time that you fell in love? Now I'm not talking about puppy love. I'm talking about real, genuine, unconditional love. Do you remember that? Just keep that in your head for 1 second. I want you to remember the time when you were walking down the store or in a library or in class and you just lock eyes with someone. That something triggers in you. Something starts brewing in you. Kundalini experience kind of feeling. Where you see this person and you just totally like, wow, love at first sight. What is this I feel? You may ask yourself. And all of a sudden, the same person is having the same energy, same feeling, and all of a sudden, this magnetic field just draws you together, just as one. And when it does, all of a sudden, you start talking and gibbering and jabbering and talking about this and that, hours upon hours on the phone. Can't wait to see this other person. Something in you just woke up where your day now makes sense. Before, you used to wake up in the morning and used to just get up to go to work. But now this time, with love in your life, the sunshine that opened up your heart chakra, now from there, all of a sudden, you are like a lion. You're unstoppable. You get up in the morning and, hello, everyone, good morning. And everybody's like, wow, what's going on? You're accelerating. What is it? Is it because I'm in love? Then all of a sudden, you start noticing that you have a lot in common with this person. Your morals, the books that you read, the movies that you watch. You begin to see that you're kind of like the same person. But like any relationship, the honeymoon bubble burst. And all of a sudden, you start seeing the defects of one another. And then from there, someone decides to move on and walk away. But wait a minute, I'm in love with you. Now you're alone now. So from being from over here in the ninth cloud, now being in the dungeons, being alone and sad. And now you're saying, what's wrong with me? Is it me that the reason why it didn't work? And you know, when love comes into your life, it brings, remember that sunshine that I said it brings into your life? That sunshine will make you see all these leeches that are all over your body. Leeches of insecurity, rejection, doubt. These leeches are just sucking your joy away. And all of a sudden, you're just hurting. And I remember watching these old Mexican movies when the man, the cowboy Mexican, his girl leaves him, and he gets a bottle of tequila and starts drinking himself away and saying, why, Maria, why did you leave me? You start hurting yourself and crying. And then all of a sudden, it comes into a point of surrender where you can no longer, your body can no longer take the abuse that you're giving yourself because you lost love. I have to say something to you. That the way I see things is your life is like a love story. Take it as a love story. I want you to see your life. Can you imagine if you go into a movie and you watch this love movie and the couples are together and they're happy the whole entire movie? I will ask for my money back. What is this? That's not true. You have to start by focusing on yourself. When you start finding the love within, this is my suggestion to you. Make yourself love you. What? You know how we're so easy trying to make someone love me? Make yourself love you. Take yourself out to a beautiful dinner by yourself. Talk to yourself. Sit there with and buy the most expensive meal there, right? And just enjoy. And it's okay if the other people are looking at you. Why is it talking? Hey, I'm making myself fall in love with me. That's what I'm doing. That's what I want to do. Make yourself a nice bath. Go put some candles, put some music, and love yourself. See, love has to start within. See, when you start loving yourself, the love of your life will come back to you. Oh, do you mean that Maria will come back into my life? No. The love was already there. See, we were confusing that because someone else says, I love you, Miguel. We automatically say, wow, I finally found love. No, the love was within you the whole entire time. All it did is by you meeting someone else that was just like you, it's just something just grew in you. And that's where the love is from the heart chakra. It's from right here. When you start to love who you are, you're no longer going to care about whoever rejects you or abandons you. When you start loving and nurturing yourself by going to the gym and taking care of your body, not to look good, but to be healthy. When you go and eat some delicious food, healthy food for your body, to go and meditate or take a nature walk. Why? Because you're spoiling yourself. You're nurturing yourself. Buy a book that will challenge your mind. Find yourself. Center yourself. Because when you will center yourself, you begin to nurture yourself. Because remember those wounds that you had after you pulled those leeches out of your body? Of insecurity and doubt? Remember that? See, you're not completely healed. But when you begin to nurture yourself and love who you are, take yourself out. Woo yourself. When you do that, then all of a sudden something in you starts growing, it starts shining, and then when you shine, you will shine within yourself, and you will shine unto others. Thank you very much.
May we please have a moment of silence while the judges complete their balance.
you, Madam Timers.
International speech contestant number 5, Otto Clark. Failure, a necessary evil. Failure, a necessary evil, Otto Clark.
Toastmaster, fellow Toastmaster, honored guests. My teacher leaned over and whispered the instructions. Okay, he said, you see that guy over there? Now that's your opponent. Now the objective is to get him to tap out. Tap out? What do you mean get him to tap out, I asked. Oh, it's simple, he reassured me. You have to put him in some sort of submission hold, either an arm bar, a leg lock, or a choke, something that renders him so helpless and in so much pain, he surrenders. And he'll let you know this by tapping out. He'll tap out his body, he'll tap you, he'll tap the ground, and in worst case scenario, he'll scream out, tap, tap, tap! Now, when this happens, you've won. Oh, sounds easy enough for me. That is until I saw the huge smile on my opponent's face. I had a sneaky suspicion that he was given the exact same direction. I was in this crazy predicament because of Miriam. Oh, Miriam. See, she was our office manager at work, and one day she grabbed me and pulled me to the side, and she said, Otto, I'm really worried about you. You spend every waking moment here at the office. Have you ever considered getting a hobby? What was she really saying? So that very same day, I decided to take lessons in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Part of it, yeah, was to spite Miriam, but I had had this long-term fascination with this exotic martial art that takes place exclusively on the ground. I could see my mother over the phone shaking her head when I told her about my latest adventure. But no time for that now. Neither she nor Miriam can help me out because the buzzer goes off and immediately my opponent just shoves me to the ground. I could feel his weight crushing down upon my chest. I couldn't move. I couldn't breathe. I felt paralyzed. Panic started to set in. And in the last-ditch effort, I decided it would be a great idea if I just tried to bench-press my opponent off me. Bad idea. He just grabbed my arm and twisted it in ways I didn't even know possible. I felt this intense pain, and immediately I started tapping as though I was playing the drums. I tapped him, I tapped me, I tapped the ground, and just in case he didn't get the hint, I screamed out, tap, tap, tap! I couldn't lift my head. Because in that moment, I realized that I had failed. No matter how grand my intentions, no matter how hard I tried, even if my life depended on it, I failed. Not only did I fail, but I announced it to the entire world, screamed it out like a newborn baby. My opponent, great guy, he just smiled and shook my hand and asked, "You ready to go again?" Oh, I didn't want to go again at all. But I had to regain my honor. Surely this was a fluke. There's no way that this could be happening to me. But it did. I failed and failed and failed. We're always taught that failure is not an option, but I'm here to tell you that sometimes it's the only option. It is the only road that leads us to success. And over the next 6 months, Felia and I became really good buddies. We were joined at the hip. He came to me with every practice and tournament, but it was a short-lived friendship because I began to realize that it took people a lot longer to tap me out, if at all. It seemed that Felia was becoming more and more of a mentor, teaching me valuable lessons, such as patience. integrity, how to adapt under stressful situations, the ability to have poise under pressure, to not care about what everybody else is thinking about you, and how to breathe. Valuable lessons that I was able to take to the workplace to show Miriam my progress and to take out to the real world. My family noticed the difference. My friends noticed the difference. I had become a new man. Fast forward 20 years later, and as a black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, you would think that I'd never get tapped out. But that's not the case. My old friend Failure pays me a visit from time to time. Just to teach me that he will be an occurrence in my life forever and a valuable source for my success. Miriam would be proud. Thank you.
Everyone, please remain silent while the judges complete their ballots and have been collected by the ballot team. Impressed year after year with the energy that you as an audience member give to the contestants. Because I can tell you that as a contestant, they're freaking out on stage like, oh, I gotta give you the best. But when you respond in kind and say, yeah, we love you, it makes the contestants better. So I'd like to begin just by applauding the audience. Yeah. Speaking of contestants, we saw a couple of repeats. We had some individuals compete in both Table Topics and International Speech. What I would like to do is I would like to have all of the contestants come and line up because I'd like to have a chance to speak with them one-on-one. So we'll begin with those that spoke in the Table Topics contest. If you remember your order, please start from here and work your way on down. I had, let's see, Roger Nelson first, followed by Miguel Contreras, followed by Otto Clark, followed by Matthew Cope, followed by Len, and then finally Michael Scampini. So before we get started, a round of applause for all of our guests. Let's get to learn a little bit about Roger. Good morning, Roger. How are you, sir?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. So let's begin by simply asking you three questions. Number one, how long have you been in Toastmasters?
I have been in Toastmasters almost forever.
I joined in 1983.
Yeah!
Yeah!
What club are you here representing today?
Hinsdale Toastmasters, 4888.
Oh. Yeah!
Hi! I'm looking for how many people are here. And then finally, what is your current Toastmasters education level?
Well, I have, of course, I've been in, when I joined, they had CTMs and ATMs, not CCs and what they're called now. So I have several CTMs and I have an ATM.
Okay. Very cool.
So that's my education.
Okay. So I'd like to ask you about your quote because it seems to have made quite a bit of impact on you. It's, today is tomorrow's yesterday. How have you taken this and how do you look through life through this lens or through this quote?
Well, I like the quote for two reasons. One, it's true. And it's just a little off, which I enjoy things that are a little
off. Yeah.
I have a little bit of a quirky sense of humor. It's actually my second favorite quote. The last several contests, I put down my favorite quote, which was, why put off until tomorrow, which you can put off indefinitely. But since I've used it,
And I remembered that quote from last time, so I had to pull you on that. Roger, thank you again for coming. I'm good. Nice to see you, Miguel. Same questions for you. Number one, how long have you been with Toastmasters?
Since January of last year.
Okay. Oh. What club are you here representing today?
Don Table Topics and Oak Brook Speakers.
Oh. Okay, very good. And then what is your current Toastmasters education level?
CC.
All right, very good. Now, Miguel, you have a lot of things on your profile, but I want to ask you just one very important question. You seem like a very romantic guy. What did you tell yourself that made you say he's the one?
By myself, right?
Yeah, well, you saw myself. Was there one line that you told yourself? Bring it, baby.
First of all, born in 1976. I'm a bicentennial child.
Dirty.
But I'm not really bi, okay? This
is
they're
killing me.
You open the door.
As you know, Toastmasters has been a therapy for me, and the speech is really about me and what made me fall in love with myself. And it's true. I did go to a very nice restaurant when I started coming out of my darkness, my shadows. And yeah, what made me fall in love with myself was the simple fact of that 12-year-old that we talked about a little while ago, the one that wanted to be a part of everyone because he was the stuttering one, and the dark, short Mexican kid, that nobody paid attention to. So I needed to like pretend to be a different person, put a different mask through a face. And I think when I finally said, you know what, I love who I am, I think that's where everything started changing in my life, and everything just started. I started attracting everything into me.
Awesome. Good morning, Otto. How are you?
Good.
Outstanding. So, same three questions. Number one, how long have you been with Toastmasters?
About a year and a half now.
Okay. What club are you here representing on stage?
I'm representing 1LC Speakeasy out of Oak Brook Terrace.
All right. And then what is your current Toastmasters education level?
CC.
Now, clearly in your speech, we talked about your attraction and your love for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I'm a martial artist myself, but I'm...
Let's do it!
I would like for you to show us a jiu-jitsu move on Matthew Collins. So, what is one of your most favorite techniques as a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu martial artist? And can you demonstrate on me very quickly with as little pain as possible? Something that you feel is like your master move.
Sure. Come on in. This is just called a Kimura. It's called a Kimura. So what I do is I grab this arm here, I go over, I make a 90 degree angle, and I come up to where I'm at. And I keep it down, and I wait for him to tap out. And if he doesn't tap out, I keep going. Kimura.
That one?
It is all recorded.
Is Bill learning that for dues and stuff?
Alright, Matthew, same three questions. Number one, how long have you been with Toastmasters?
I think 12 months or 13 months. March of last year.
Nice. And what club are you representing on stage this morning?
Axiom Masters. Yeah!
Yeah! What is your current Toastmasters education level?
I think I'm on speech 8 of the competitive. Obviously, I can't communicate. I'm not quite there yet. Almost. Two more to go.
Two more hits of coffee. So, Matthew, you have a lot of information here, but I'm very fascinated by one aspect of you and the way that you think. Why do you like Sloppy Joe so much?
I barely ever have them. And I was like super excited to have a Sloppy Joe, like I eat them once a year. And they're like so good and they just like fall every place that you scoop it and it's just
like,
phenomenal.
It's kind of like ribs though. Like you can just like get it all.
If you can get everywhere, you're like, all right, Sloppy Joe's.
Did your wife ever make the Sloppy Joe's again after that point? See the hands on the finger, so then that's the. Very good. So tell me about your little girls. They seem to be a very central part of your life. Yeah. Tell me about your two little girls.
Their name is Vivian and Madeline. Vivian is 2. Madeline is 4 months now. So, so they're a very central part of my life. So I need to get home. When I'm doing Toastmasters, she's like, make sure it doesn't affect our family life.
Too late. Too late.
Fantastic. Number one, how long have you been with Toastmasters?
5.5 years.
All right. Nice. Number two, what club are you representing on stage this morning?
Woodridge 983.
All right. And what is your current Toastmasters education level?
CC and CL.
CC and CL. So there's two things I want to talk to you about. Clearly, there's a lot of, I've met you over the years, I've gotten to know you, you're a great guy. One of the things that you find attractive as a quality in people is tenacity. Can you share us a story of you having seen tenacity in your wife that made you go, God, this is the person for me?
Oh, yeah. That's it.
Be careful.
I'm a matchmaker on stage.
First off, June will be 44 years of wedded bliss. Our friends all think that's a great sign of her tenacity. I don't quite get the joke. But in 1983, you talk about landmines in your life. We were announced that my job was being eliminated, but I got an offer to relocate to Chicago from Pennsylvania. And that was all fun enough, but we were waiting for our second child to be born, and we knew nobody up in Chicago. And so this was really to be looked forward to, right? And it was the middle of winter. We moved halfway across the country, and the day we moved into our house in Homer Glen, my daughter is now 8 weeks old, my son is just shy of 3 years old. I get up on the first day to go to work, and I'm snowed in. And she's saying, where did you take me? So, as she has lived through that, and we're still live together in the same house. So,
wow.
That's tenacity.
Yeah.
Let
tell me about the Mensa annual convention. What is Mensa?
We've talked in our club about the connections and networking you can do out of Toastmasters, and this is one of the examples. Deb Johnson is a member of Mensa and invited a couple of us from our club to apply to be a speaker, breakout speaker at their annual convention in October. 2 years ago, I was accepted to give a speech on customer service, and then, despite that, I was invited back and for last year, and I took the leap and I did two presentations, and it turned out great. So that's how that came to be.
All right. Well,
through Toastmasters.
Thank you for your knowledge and your timey. Good morning, Michael. How are you?
Good morning. Good.
Fantastic. Same three questions. Number one, what club are you? I'm sorry, how long have you been in Toastmasters?
Since February 2015.
Okay. What club are you here representing on stage?
Windy City Professional Toastmasters. Also, I like to say I represent all my clubs. I also represent New Lenox Toastmasters and Lincoln Way Toastmasters as well.
All right.
And then finally, what is your current Toastmasters educational level?
I'm ACS and CL.
Okay, very good.
Wow.
So you are, of all the speakers here, you have listed here on your profile improv at Second City as part of your hobby.
Yes.
I know several Toastmasters that are involved in that. Can you, in 60 seconds or less, tell us what improv is and how it has helped you in life and in Toastmasters?
Sure. So improv is basically thinking on your feet. People think of it more as comedy, but really it's about just accepting the situation and going with it. And I've learned so many lessons. I've actually given speeches on it. That's how valuable it's been for me. And I was introduced to it by Ellen Schnur, if you guys know her.
Yeah.
Okay, so she came to our Toastmasters club and she did the workshop with us, and I've done like two or three of hers, and that's what got me and Garrett Gray to join Improv at Second City. I'm in level C right now, and I'm going to actually be on stage in a few weeks for my graduation of the class. So
participating this morning. Here's a certificate of participation. Ladies and gentlemen, please give one full round of applause for all of our presenters. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been an honor and a real privilege for me to serve as your contest Toastmaster. I would be remiss if I did not just take 15 seconds and thank one particular individual this morning. I have been traveling for quite a few days outside, and I showed up last night at 10 o'clock. It has been a rough morning, and one person identified that and brought me coffee. And for those of you that know, caffeine and sugar, yeah, that's what I live off of. So I would like to take a moment and thank Michelle Lansky for helping me. It is now my honor and privilege to turn this contest over to our Southwest Division Director, Mr. Lawrence Hill.
Hello, everybody. It's been a great contest happening.
Yeah.
I think everybody here was a winner. Everybody that participated was a winner, and I'd like us to give them another round of applause. Of winners, I would like to bring the district director up, Ms. Ivy Gwynn, and Ms. Quintet. And what we're going to do now, we're going to find out who the illustrious winners were today. They're really all winners, but we're going to find out what order they came in today. We're going to start out with the table topics. And the second place winner for the 2017 Spring Table Topics winner is...
Mr. Contest Master, are we going to announce three trophies or just two? Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
And we should point out the reason isn't because there are only four contestants in the table topic speech. And part of Toastmasters International Rules is if you have four, you only announce the first and second.
Yep.
We will give the third person.
Of course.
Okay. We'll give it after.
Who's second?
No more suspense.
Okay, for the table topic speech contest, second place winner is going to be Mr. Matthew Colt.
All right.
Yeah. Now, drum roll. For first place in the street contest, Table Topics, Mr. Otto Park. Going to take us into the presentation for the International Speech Contest. In the International Speech Contest, Spring 2017, the third place winner is going to be Mr. Michael Scarpini. All right. Got a third place, that means it's going to be a second place. So without delay, second place, Mr. Otto Clark. For the Spring 2017 International Speech Contest, Mr. Matthew Cole.
Before the 31st of March. Great. I'm going to give you dinner on Friday. Enjoy yourself. We're going to celebrate on Friday night. Remember this. Toastmasters is about your education. You're being able to communicate to your bosses, tell them where you are. Do not lose track of that. It's about communicating and your education. And with that, I'm going to turn it back to him.
He got to turn it back to me. Hey, we're going to do a quick photo op, and then we're going to dismiss. If the winners
get dismissed first.
Okay, we're going to do a photo op. Come on.
Then we're going to do a photo op.
We're going to adjourn. And we're going to ask that the winners come up for the photo op.
All right, give us a tap. We're tapping out.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, if you are a winner, bring up your trophies, no certificates.